So Paul has just shown us that if you take a degenerate ball of electrons or a white dwarf star, there is a particular point where if you add one extra piece of material, the star's gravity is going to be able to overcome the pressure of the electrons, the degeneracy pressure, as we like to say, and the thing is going to want to run away and start shrinking to a black hole. Now, that is the calculation that Chandrasekhar did in a slightly more sophisticated fashion that ultimately won him a Nobel Prize. So you have just seen how to win a Nobel Prize about 85 years after the effect, after the event. Well done, Paul.
My pleasure. But how do we actually get a white dwarf this big? I mean, it needs to be pushed over the limit. You add that last wafer-thin mint to make it go bang. How would you actually get a white dwarf that large?
So it turns out that most white dwarfs, like the white dwarf that our sun will eventually make, are going to weigh between 0.6 and 0.7 times the mass of our sun. Stars that are bigger, more massive than our sun, up to about maybe 7 or 8 times the mass of the sun, produce white dwarfs that are probably 1.2 times the mass of the sun. And that turns out not quite to be where we need to be.
Where's the rest of the mass of the star gone then? If you've got a 7 solar mass star, it turns into 1.2 solar mass white dwarf. Where's it gone?
So the center turns into the white dwarf and it blows off all the rest into a nebula, which we typically call planetary nebula.
Like the pretty pictures we saw earlier.
Exactly. So we can get them up to 1.2, but that's not where we need to be. So it turns out there's a number of ways to make a white dwarf exceed what we call the Chandrasekhar mass of 1.4 times the mass of the sun. So one way to do it is we see through these classical novae. So as you take material on or accrete the material and it blows off, sometimes the explosions are such that you leave material behind so that the star is continually getting heavier as it accretes material.
So you might dump a certain amount of mass in this explosion, maybe 50% of it's blown off and 50% might stay behind.
Exactly.
And then more stuff accumulates and then you get slowly adding an extra layer after an extra layer.
Yeah, and that turns out that's often not the case. Actually, the explosion sometimes makes the star less. But there are situations where it can make the star heavier. We talked about earlier the idea that material as it comes onto the star can be fusing on the way in and deposit it as helium. And it is possible, as you deposit helium, for that helium to essentially not be degenerate and burn on the surface, convert to carbon and oxygen, and in that way, make a star slowly rise up to that magic 1.4 solar mass mark.
So it's like a fusion-burning star, but instead of the fusion being in the middle, the fusion's in a shell around the edge, but it's still burning gently because it's not in a degenerate level.
Yeah, that's
so
right.
So the pressure can regulate itself.
And then finally, we can have a situation where imagine you have two white dwarfs together that are orbiting each other. Now, you might think they would orbit each other forever, but it turns out that they are releasing gravitational radiation. They're actually making space go through and do a little whoop whoop, and that takes energy away. And over billions of years, those stars, if they're close enough to start out with, will end up merging. When they merge, you get a catastrophic event where two, maybe 0.7 or 0.8 solar mass stars merge into one big one, and so then you'll exceed that magic place and explode.
Okay, so let's say this has happened. We've taken a white dwarf, we've added that last little teaspoonful of material, so the whole thing's gone over the limit. We've done it more catastrophically by colliding two of these things together. What's going to happen now? It's going to start shrinking. The mass is now over the limit, so wouldn't it just keep on shrinking without limit till it gets down to zero size?
So, obviously, it would turn into a black hole before it reached zero size. But it turns out that carbon, well, many stars can burn carbon. If you add carbon and add a helium atom to it, or what we call an alpha particle, you can make oxygen and you can add the helium to oxygen and make sequentially heavier elements. And so the density and the temperature inside one of these white dwarf stars is so high that it's close to the ability to start burning carbon, but not quite. But when you squeeze it that last little bit, when you go over that magical mark, you reach the point very quickly where you can burn carbon. And of course it's, again, degenerate, so temperature and pressure are kind of independent of each other, and once you start burning, the whole thing is going to burn as fast as it can go.
Yeah, so we talked earlier about the white dwarfs weren't doing fusion because they were carbon oxygen, but that was at the density of a white dwarf, so we're now shrinking it down. that can burn. You don't get as much energy out of carbon and oxygen in fusion as you do out of hydrogen, but you still get a fair amount if you can fuse carbon and oxygen all the way to the most stable element, iron. So let's actually calculate how much energy you can get from one of these things.